questions on Newton's laws? About Newton's laws? He can turn them in next time, but we've got to start class. We don't have all of time, okay? Any other questions about Newton's laws? That makes sense to everybody? Okay? All right, so then we're going to move on to Boyle's laws. That's the next part there.
What's it that for?
Good for you. Maybe you can teach us. You can help teach. Alright, so this is what it should look like in you guys' books, page 34. Boyle's laws, okay? So, first thing he talks about here is matter. You guys know about matter, right? Three states of matter. Solids, liquids, and gases, right? It's right up here. So matter always has specific characteristics. Gases, for example, don't have a fixed volume or a shape. Liquids have a fixed volume but not a fixed shape, right? And solids have a fixed volume and a fixed shape. Okay? So, what we talk about here in Boyle's Law, we talk about pressure. Who knows what pressure is? I raise your hand. Yeah? Builds up over time. Good.
Something with atoms and
meters. Good guess. Perfect. Good. Has something to do with force. Anybody else? So, pressure is measured as the force per area, is how it's measured. Okay? So, if I have a scale like this, okay, and I stand on that scale, I put a lot of force on it, okay? So, this is my total weight, so I'll call it W, and my weight is equal to the force. My mass times gravity. Okay? And then on the floor, there's a normal force, a reaction force, right? Every force has an equal and opposite reaction force. And so the floor puts back a force, and we'll call it the normal force because it's normal. so because these forces cancel each other out, if I stand on the scale or on the floor, we know that the velocity when that happens is equal to 0 meters per second. And the acceleration is 0 meters per second because I'm not moving, so the acceleration is 0. Which means that this force here goes to 0. Okay? And this force here, because they're equal, they have to go to 0. So they're going to cancel each other out. So then our net force will be equal to our weight plus my normal force. Because we have weight and our normal force. Yes, sir?
What is the Q?
Q? This is A, sorry. Acceleration. And this is A, acceleration. Okay? And so, we know that weight is going down, and so we'll call this weight negative. Okay? And so our net force has some mass times acceleration. And we know that that acceleration is 0, and so the whole net force here is 0. Okay? Any questions here? This is kind of what we talked about a little bit earlier, review of Newton's forces. Force is mass times acceleration. Our net force is the combination of all of our forces put together. Okay?
Can I
actually learn what is awesome? Yes, that's what we're getting to. So, when we talk about pressure, we talk about force divided by an area, okay? So, what the area is the total surface area right there. You guys know how to do areas?
Yeah.
Okay, that one's even worse. Okay. So let's say this side is, we'll call it L, just length. And this side we'll call B for base. Okay, so we'll have that our area is equal to our length times our base.
Length
times width. Okay. I would use width, but we already have W. I don't want to use W again, so I use B. Okay. So then our pressure, which we'll call P, is equal to force divided by area. Okay. In this case, that will be mass times gravity divided by length times base, right? Because our force is our mass times gravity, and our area is our length times our base. Okay? And so we get to add a new thing over here, pressure is equal to force divided by area, and it has units of what they call pascals. And so that's just a newton over a meter squared is a pascal. Because newton is from force and area is a meter squared.
I could have called it
a
meter squared.
It could, but that would get really long. You had to write everything out. It's a newton meter squared. Little bit, but I mean, if I made up all this stuff, I'd probably name it after me too. Because I think it was kind of cool. We'll start calling stuff Kobe's. Yeah, Potter's, right? Okay, so this is pressure of a force onto a solid object, but everything exerts force. Even the air around us exerts force. It's just not a very big force. We don't feel it very strongly. Okay? So if we had a jar like this. Inside that jar there's air, right? And it puts a force, so all of this air puts a little force down onto this jar. And say this jar is on a table or something, then this table will put some force back onto the jar. Okay? And really, that air, because like we talked about with water, fluids and gases, they put force out in every direction because they want to go down. So if I have like a tub like this full of water, there's water pushing down this way, but there's also water pushing out this way, right? Because water and gases, all things that don't have a set volume, will spread out to fill whatever container they have, right? That's a property push out. And so actually the force inside of a sealed jar, if I close this, the force is actually the same in every direction. Because that air is trying to push every which way it can to try and spread out. But it's not that strong, so it won't break the glass, right? What changes, if you put more air in there, then the force becomes greater. And then you maybe could make enough force to break the glass, right? So, how we deal with this is we say that so we can say inside of here there's a pressure. So we'll call it P1, because this is situation 1, okay? And we have a volume 1. And I'm going to put little wings up like these so we know that it's not velocity, but it's volume. Volume is meters cubed, right? Because we have meters, meters, and then meters. Okay. Does that make sense so far?
Sounds like
meters. So, pressure 1, volume 1. If we took all of that same amount of air, and we squished it down and put it into a smaller jar, one only like this big, we have some new type of pressure because we've changed things. And we have a new volume because we made it smaller. We condensed everything, right? But if we take the same amount of air and all the same force that's in here and we move it, these two have to be the same. Okay? So that's the first part of the Boyle's law. Is that P1 times V1 has to be the same as P2 times V2. Okay? So the initial pressure and the initial volume is the same as the final pressure and the final volume times together. Now, what that means, originally, probably what you're thinking is, well, I can't take more air and put it into a smaller container, right? I couldn't do this and move it into here, because that would change these, right? But it turns out you can change one of these as long as the other one changes in a way to balance things out, okay? So let's say you have a pump, okay? You guys have seen like bicycle pump, right? Like this, and then there's a handle up here like this or something, right? And so at first, our level maybe is this much, okay? So this is V1. And when we have V1, we have some P1. I don't know what it is, but that's what it is. Okay? Then as you push that handle down, our new volume is maybe like this much. Okay? And so now we have V2. And let's say that V1 is, 1 cubic meter. Okay? And V2, people say, is 1/2. It's half as big, okay? Because it's being squished down by that pump, by the handle. We know that the pressures have to equal out, right? This law is true. And so if we know P1, we'll say is 1 pascal, or we'll say it's 2. Okay? We'll say P1 times V1 has to be equal to P2 times V2. We know P1 is 2 pascals. We know V1 is 1 cubic meter. We know that we don't know P2, right? That's what we want to find. And we know V2 is 1/2 a cubic meter. If we solve for P2 using algebra, what would we do? Anybody know what we would do here in this situation to get P2 by itself? It's not the same as saying like 1 P1 and 1 P1 is P2. That's not what we're saying here. That would make sense in a certain situation. But what we're saying here is that P1 is not the same as P2. Okay? B2 is just what we called it because it's changed now. So this is state 1, and this is state 2. So you couldn't do that. That's a good idea, though. But we could call these anything, anything. So we could just say this is A, B, C, D. They're totally different from each other. But we know that this relationship, this formula, has to be true. So what we want to do is just get rid of this one half, right? So we could times both sides by 2, right? And that would cancel that out, but you have to do it to both sides, right? That's just algebra. Okay. Or you can divide by 1/2, right? But that's the same as times complexity. So now that we've times both sides by 2, we have P2 by itself is equal to 2 times 2 is 4 times 1. So we have 4 pascals times meters cubed. Okay? And we know that a pascal is a newton divided by a meter squared. And so if we have a newton divided by meter squared times meter cubed, these will cancel out. Two of those, and so we'll be left with just one here. And so we will have 4 newton meters as our P2. Okay? So we can see we started with a pressure of 2 pascals, and we went up to 2. Oh, hang on. No, sorry. I forgot that we times by a meter cubed here. Sorry. So let me erase this real quick. I'm sorry. So we should have P2 is equal to 2 meters cubed times 1 meter cubed times 2 pascals. And this is, sorry, 2 over meters cubed. So those cancel out. We just have pascals, 2 times 2. So sorry, that one got confusing because I messed up. But this relationship here, the P1, V1, is equal to P2, V2. So this helps us, if we know the initial pressure and the initial volume, then we can find one of the other pressure volumes. Okay. Are there questions here for that one? Nobody? I know it's not super clear, so should we try and do an example from homework? ATM stands for atmospheres, okay? So that means we consider, well, they've decided what the pressure of the air, the atmosphere is, right here at our height, at sea level, actually. And they made that one atmosphere. So this is 1.5 times the pressure of air at sea level, okay? And next.
And compressed gas
to
its volume is 4.8 liters.
Okay, stop. So that sounds like a new volume. 4.8 liters, okay?
What will the new pressure inside the piston be?
Okay, so we're looking for P2, okay? Right, question mark. Okay, so we know our formula, our equation, is V1 times P1 is equal to V2 times P2, right? The only thing we don't know is P2, so we're going to divide by V2 figure out P2. here so far. Now we're going to plug in our numbers here to see if we can figure out what this actually is supposed to be. So V1 is 5.6 liters. P1 is 1.5 atmospheres. V2 was 4.8 liters. And from this point, you can use a calculator to figure out what it is exactly. Okay, should we do one more example?
Yes.
Let's do one more. Which one do you want? Number two or number three?
Three.
Okay. Can I erase this here?
Yeah.
Somebody said no.
I need it.
Still need it? Should we erase this over here then? Has everybody got this down that they want to take notes of? Okay, what does number three say? One person to read for me. Yes, please.
I've got a car with an internal volume of 12,000 liters.
Okay, it's not 12,000 liters. Like that? Okay, so that's our V1, right? Okay.
If I drive my car into the river and it implodes, what will be the volume of the gas when the pressure goes from 1 atm to 1.4 atm?
So we start at 1 atm pressure, and we end up with 1.4. Is that what it says? Right? Okay. So we know V1. We know P1. We know P2. The only thing we don't know is
V2. Oh, yeah, you just have P1 and V1.
Right? So we have V1 times P1 is equal to V2 times P2. We want to get V2 by itself, so what are we going to do?
Divide
what?
The V1 times P1 by P2.
By P2. So we can get rid of P2 on both sides, right?
Yeah.
So we're going to say V1 times P1 divided by P2. And that should just be equal to V2, right? Because we're going to cancel those out. Okay? And then we're just going to plug some numbers in here. See if we can figure out what it's supposed to be. Okay? So V1 was 12,000 liters. P1 was 1 atmosphere, all that divided by 1.4 atmospheres, right?
Okay. It's not really 12,000
Same thing, right? This time in by one, it changes it all. Okay? And if you get a calculator, you can figure out what the answer is. Questions here on how we got that?
Yeah, we made a lot of mistakes.
Yes, sir.
So, it's a question to what if the decimal is going on for a while, did you just shorten it?
You can just shorten it. If you can round to probably two decimal places.
That one made so much more sense.
That one made more sense? Okay. So, what about number two? So you have to make sure you recognize, this should be your first step every time, okay? What do they tell you? Do they tell you volume in number two? They tell you you have 15 liters, right, which is volume. At a pressure of sea level, so P1 is 1 atmosphere. If you take the balloon to a different pressure, then your pressure changes. What is your new volume? So it's set up just like this one. You just gotta change some of the numbers, okay? Yes?
So, on this one, it says I've added 15 liters. Is that the volume?
That's the first one, right? So that's the first volume that it gives you. So a balloon originally is empty, right? You have a balloon and you're blowing it up and you add. At first, your balloon's just empty. It doesn't have anything in it. So you have to add something to it to get an initial velocity, a volume, right? And then you have your first pressure where you did it at. As you move in elevation, you get a different pressure, okay? And then you should have a different volume because your pressure's changed. That would give you P1, right? V2 divided by V1, P1 would give you P2. Yeah, it's set up just the same way as we did here, right? It's going to be set up just like this one. It's just going to have different numbers.
Hey, can you do 15 divided by
0.85? That's the one thing you're going to have to do anyway. That's literally it, right? So when you go on your Chromebook, you pull up a little calculator on the Chromebook, and you can plug it in. Okay? Any other questions here? This is called Boyle's Law.
Okay, I have that.
He has more, but this is crazy. There's one that changes with temperature. So the hotter a gas is, the more pressure it has. But those ones get, yeah, they get a little complicated. So you now have Boyle's Law as homework for next time, but you really only have problem two, because we had number one and number three in class, right? Okay. Yes, ma'am.
Number two, can you round it?
Yes. Yes. Yeah. You can round it probably two decimal places is good. Okay. So to the hundredth place. All right. Sense why pressure changes as you move from place to place? Yes? Everybody's a yes?
Yes.
A little bit? No. Because not everybody's done and I don't want to get them all mixed up. Does it make sense why? change when you go underwater. Alright. So the next topic we have is our next project. If you want to do two, you can, but you only have to do one, okay? Okay, so the regulation is the soda bottle cannot be deformed in any way. Can't be melted, warped, or cut, because if there's any holes in it, you'll lose all your pressure, and you won't get any force, okay? The thread of the bottle, where the cap goes on, that part's important, because that's where we're going to hold on to. So the threads should be free of obstructions. You can't cover the threads at all, and you can't change them in any way, okay? They're a ring around the bottleneck that we use to hold the launching clamps, okay? So usually there's the screw part on it, and then there's kind of a lip around it. The clamp is going to hold onto that lip, and it's going to go around the screw, and that's where the pressure's going to be, okay? So they're going to fly. So if you have your soda bottles kind of like this, right? And there's that little lip like this. And then this is where the screws are. Okay? It's going to hold on to it right here. Okay, so it's going to fly like this. It's going to fly with the little weird sand thing on the top that you're down. Okay? So you can't change the lip of it, and you can't change the threads of it at all. Okay? No additional propulsion devices other than those approved can be allowed. So you can only have air and water inside of your water bottle. Air and water.
So, for the procedure, it says that we needed something about We need more than one.
So, if you want to construct two bottle rockets, you can, but only one per group is required.
Only one?
Only one per group is required, but if you wanted to do two, you could. I'm pretty sure you can't bring outside food onto campus, except for lunchtime. So what we're going to do is we're going to have two clamps that hold the opening of the bottle up against the rubber seal, and then we're going to use a hand pump to push air into the bottles with the tube. So there's a maximum allowable pressure that we'll decide. So we'll have a reader, and if it goes above a certain pressure, that's as high as it can go, and then we'll release it. Okay. Any other questions? Yes?
Can we put fins and nose cones on the
top? I will bring some construction paper to class next time so that you guys can build fins, swings, cones, whatever else you want. Let's use only what we have in class, so it's fair for everybody. So I have this cardstock construction paper. So it's pretty sturdy. It should be pretty good. We'll have scissors, hot glue guns here in class.
Yes.
Why? No. There won't be any. You can, if you want to find somewhere to attach it to, I guess. But I don't think you'll need it. Back there, we have a question?
No.
Never mind. Okay. Right here. You guys will need to make your rocket. You guys will need to design your rocket to travel as high and as far as you can. can't change the bottle in and of itself, but you guys will have this paper. So I would pump it up, and then you guys can maybe press the release button. We'll see. I don't know how the pump works exactly, but so we'll pump it up full of air, and we'll fill it. The pressure will build, but the volume stays the same. So the force from the pressure, like we just talked about, is only going to shoot out of the bottom of it. Question over here. Yeah, so I will have this cardstock paper, tape, hot glue guns, and scissors. Okay, back there.
So, who's the winner? Does it like the highest or the longest time in the year?
So, there's scoring right here, as you can see. Right. So, there will be uniqueness, ingenuity, function, and design. Height, and then data acquisition, and graphical interpretation. Those are the four, those are the three categories of grading. Okay.
So we're not learning about the
lump,
we're learning about after.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so the lump is the same for everybody. Okay, it's going to be the same pump, the same clamps, the same setup there. So your design that you need, guys, need to figure out is a little more about flying than the pressure. But we haven't learned about pressure, so we know why this is happening, right? No, no soda, nothing else can be inside the bottle, just water and air, okay? Say that again. You can bring your own lunch. But we can't have snacks during class time, typically, so. Okay. So if you guys open up your binders, you'll see all that information on page 41 in case you forget anything, okay? And so then this is what your testing will actually look like, okay? So you're going to have your rocket. We'll try and see if we can launch them all 5 times. So that's why each group only needs one. If you have two, we might not have enough time to do two, okay? So pick one that's your favorite, and if we have more time, you can try again. So we'll test the volume, okay? Your volume should stay about the same, but you'll decide whether you want a volume of water or a volume of air. Is there a benefit to having water in? Is there a benefit to all just having air? We'll see how long it stays in the air, so how long its air time is. We'll talk about the air pressure inside the bottle and the air time. Okay. We'll need to weigh your rockets, and then you'll talk about how could you have made your rocket travel higher, how much pressure was in your rocket when it traveled the highest. And then we'll use graphing paper to show your flight time. So did your rocket go like straight up and then down? Did it go up and out like this? Did it go, how did it fly? So that's what we'll talk about in the next week. We'll get more into bridges, okay? So everybody by next time needs to try and bring a 20-ounce soda bottle. Okay?
20 ounce.
Is it right here? It's in your binder. Just give me a 2 people in a group. Okay, unless we really need a group of 3, but I think there's 30 people in this class, so we should have groups of 15, 2 people in a group. I know some people are missing today. Okay, so let's see if we can't with the next. We have 9 minutes, so can you guys form a group and decide what kind of design you want? By keeping it quiet still. Keep it quiet, okay? Raise your hand if you don't have a group here. And we'll put you guys together. Raise your hand if you don't have a group yet. Just you? Who else? You guys are a group right here? You guys are a group right here? Is that okay? You two are a group? You two are a group? Is that okay? And then, are you two a group? You two are a group? One, two, be a group? Okay, well, we only have people who are here today. People who That's why you were finding those groups. Okay, so you three right here. Okay. So decide who's bringing a 20-ounce water bottle or soda bottle, whatever. The shape of the bottle can be different depending on what you get, right? Some bottles are more aerodynamic.